Welcome everybody, and we would be sharing a small video initially about our experience running a mobile unit. And this is called Nayana, and it has been now running for 12 years without a break. And it has covered almost about 1.5 million miles on the road, and still going strong. And the same equipment which we purchased and put up initially are the same ones which we are using. We've added a few more equipment. So can we have the video, please? Video. With the voice.
Excuse me? Video.
Nayana, a mobile eye clinic initiated by the Vitala International Institute of Ophthalmology and funded by the World Diabetes Foundation, made its maiden voyage in March 2006. The mobile clinic travels 25 days a month. Since Nayana has been on the road, it has done over 150,000 kilometers on unfriendly terrain over long periods of time without transport damage to the equipment. To start with, the instruments are packed in custom-made form-fit molds to minimize shock impact. The cases are then loaded onto this rail-mounted cage and secured by Velcro straps. The cage moves in all directions. This takes care of not only road conditions, but movements caused by gear change, acceleration, and braking. Another problem is the constant vibrations caused by the engine, tires, and resonance created by the vehicle body. This is addressed by designing a rivetless aluminium body and hard I-beams. These beams create a buffer between the chassis and the floor of the van, reducing vibrations. The power generation equipment is isolated from the vehicle when it is to be operated. A noiseless air conditioning system is used along with vibration dampening inner wall packing using polyurethane foam.
Care was taken to make sure that these things could be duplicated. Or if I wanted to build another van, it could be built with off-the-shelf components. And the design was made in such a way that it can be easily given and easily duplicated in any country.
Another reason Nayana has been on the road so long is the sound economic model that is in place.
When we planned Nayana, what we thought was that we should not deprive a patient, poor patient, of treatment because he cannot afford. Now, for a paying patient, we decided to charge a nominal amount. We could meet our entire cash expenses with just about 30% of this. We decided that we would give the remaining 70% to the participating doctors. Now, remember, these are busy practitioners, and for them to wholeheartedly participate in this, they should find it economically feasible. And I attribute most of the success of Nayana for this sound economic model.
The economic model encourages doctors to enhance their own referral networks locally so as to cover as many diabetic patients as possible. As for the patients, they pay much less than this treatment would cost them in a comparable facility in their nearest town.
It's a win-win situation for patients.
She can go alone with any kid and afford the treatment over here. It's lesser than 10% of what we spent for our father.
It's a win-win situation for each of the participating doctors.
Our diabetic workup has definitely improved.
Nayana has definitely made my practice more comprehensive.
I feel very complete in my professional practice.
And a win-win situation for the organization which is bringing the equipment.
This, in short, sort of summarizes what we set out to do. And now, subsequent to this film, this was made sometime in 2007 or 2008, subsequent to that, it has run along. We've also partnered with the government of Karnataka, and we are covering an entire district and trying to train the government ophthalmologists also to utilize the facility. And we have a screening program also built into the government system. So these are some of the things. We now provide an OCT scan on the mobile. And yeah, glaucoma and this thing were the diabetes, diabetic retinopathy were the two things we tried to address in this project that we did. We used the local ophthalmologists and sort of empowered them with equipment which they would find difficult to invest in and put it down. Because many of them, when I went for the initial survey, were just looking at a case to see if there was a cataract or not. And the fundus examination was not even an essential part of the screening which they were doing. That changed, because once they saw that there was a earning potential there, A, B, they could give an added service to their patient, they started looking at the fundus and picking up diabetic retinopathy. They started looking for glaucoma, and they would pool their cases for the monthly one visit of this van and do the treatments on the van. And for the first 3 years, one of us traveled with the van and trained them. And after 3 years, subsequently, they are running it now by themselves. And in fact, many of the original group have purchased their own equipment now, and we have moved to other areas. So from the group, I would like to know what you would like to discuss from this. Any questions you have, any thoughts?
So let me address that question slightly more. If I may add to the question is, how do you make it worthwhile in terms of cost of running and things like that? There are three components to this. First is the cost of the equipment itself, which we call as capital cost. Where does this come from? This typically needs to come from either a grant or if you're making an investment. The reason why I'm saying making an investment is basically because there are two commercial ventures which are running this as well. The people have put in money and then actually running it at a profit. The second one is your ongoing costs. This includes your AMCs, your fuel costs, your supply costs, your insurance, your repairs, all these things together. Then the third thing is, what is it that you're able to recover the income from the patients? So how do you price it? Let's say, take a typical example. Let's take your example. Let's say Nagpur, an ophthalmic hospital is able to provide a single sitting of PRP at 2,000 rupees. Is it worthwhile for you to price it at 2,000 rupees in, let's say, Amravati, or possibly in some other village or some other small town around Nagpur? Is it possible to do that? Now, if it's not making economic sense to the patient will not come, because there is no barrier to come to Nagpur, or maybe it's difficult, but if it's not going to save substantially, it's not going to come. So you have to protect revenue as well as generate income. These are two challenges that come. So typical cost that I was telling you about, this van now runs about 4,500 kilometers every month. It runs 23 days. The cost of running the van, if you distill out the capital cost, regeneration, replacement cost, everything, it costs about 10 to 12,000 rupees a day. Now, this is not fuel cost and salary cost. This is also, I'm putting away money to rebuy the equipment at some point of time. Okay? If you do that, it costs about 10,000 rupees per day to run. So that's about 10,000 rupees a day. So the actual cash outflow will be about 4,000 to 5,000 rupees a day. The rest of the money goes towards your insurance, your replacement, laser head needs to get replaced. You might want to replace your crystal on your green lasers, whatever, buy insurance. So this is something. And maybe at some point of time, you might want to buy a new equipment like an OCT. We just bought a 40 lakh rupee OCT to go on the van. And then a lot of the manufacturers will not support moving the vehicle or moving the equipment around. That's the big challenge. So we have to convince them. And the insurance companies will not give you. There are no typical insurances for this. We had to negotiate all that. If you factor in all these costs, your revenue outflow, if you want to run 300 days a year, is about 30 lakhs. The income potential is about 45 lakhs. You can actually make that money. But what happens? Why do we not make that extra 15 lakhs? Is because that 15 lakhs, because it's an NGO, because it's a charitable venture, we use that money to treat poor patients. The agreement that we have with the local doctors is, we will give you this equipment for free. You allow us to tell who is poor, who is not poor. So what happens is typically about 80%, 75 to 80% of patients pay some fee, which is a differential fee to the nearest large hospital. So if, let's say, I go 100 kilometers outside Bangalore, and Bangalore costs about 2,000 rupees per sitting, this would be charged 1,000 rupees at the rural place. But what the patient is also getting is that it's local. He can have follow-up. He can, if suppose he has redness the next day, he can go back and see his ophthalmologist. He's not traveling. He's back home in possibly 3 hours, 4 hours instead of a full day. So we came out with something called the total cost of treatment, TCT. So on a comparable basis, even if it is your cost to the patient can be moved as close to 2,000 rupees as possible, actually. You can actually bring it up to 1,500. People will still pay because his cost of coming to Bangalore, going back, losing a day's pay, coming with an attendant, all that is reduced. We have not faced any resistance from patients wanting to pay. We started at very nominal rates. We started about 300, 400 rupees. Now we have brought it to near commercial rates. Because there are two things. One is there are many participants in a location who have now invested. What is the thing that prevents a small town doctor from investing in, let's say, a 30 lakh rupee laser is he just does not have that many cases to repay him back, and the laser is going to die in like 6 or 7 years, right? So in 7 years, you have to recover all your money, possibly for the investment, or somebody should donate that equipment. There are only two ways in which this will work. So to answer your question again, very simply, it will cost about 10,000 rupees a day. The revenue potential is between 14 to 15,000 rupees a day. That's your share. I'm not talking about what the local doctor makes. The local doctor also typically makes 10 to 12,000 rupees a day.
This 10,000 would include what equipment?
The vehicle has a green laser, the vehicle has a YAG laser, the vehicle has a HFA, it has a OCT, it has a fundus camera, it has an angiogram. And obviously, it's little, yeah. Yeah.
The same Smith lamp as yours. And then we have a V-scanner again. We have an OCT scanner. And then we have got the array of lenses, including the cornea lenses and listening for any iridotomy and also angle assessment in case they want to do that. And we UV and we provide. Yeah, that's a lot of field analyzer, visual field analyzer.
Correct. Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. So the first thing we did was to go around and talk about this whole project. And initially, we had about 83 people who sort of signed in and said we would be interested to have this come. So the idea is that you're training them on their own patients. Okay. The second step was one of us would travel, myself and my brother, who's also a vitreoretinal surgeon, and my wife, who's a glaucoma specialist. So either one of us would be on the van, and we would go to different places. So suppose it went to a particular place where the doctor had pulled in about 20 cases. So initially, we would go through the 20 cases with him, discuss all the aspects. Now, this has a side-viewing system for the laser. You can just put the training.
Can we get the presentation up? We want
to train the doctor yourself.
Yes. So we would go and we would have theory classes initially so that they understand what we are trying to treat. The second step would be that you would do the treatment. So while you are lasering, he is watching through the sight tube, seeing how you are spacing your laser burns, where you are deciding to treat. When we started it, intravitreal injections were not a part of the armamentarium. Subsequently, even that we have introduced and trained people about. So that was like you can see my brother watching through the sight tube while another doctor is treating. And then once you do that, the next step is they start treating and you observe. So then you create one small square in the nasal periphery, ask them to fill up while you are observing. So once he gets the hang of how to do the laser, then you watch him do the macular laser last. And finally, you stop commenting and just stand back, and he continues.
How long will that be?
3 years. 3 years.
But see, three years is not continuous. It's 1 day a month.
1 day a month for each of the doctors, but for us it was 3 full years. So in the first year, I was traveling 3 days on the van, and my brother was traveling 2 days on the van. Then subsequent to that, I had a set of 5 very good vitreoretinal fellows with me, who would also travel on a rotation basis with this thing. So for the first 3 calendar years, we handheld them. And then subsequently, we moved it into a sort of a cooperative arrangement where they become equal stakeholders in sort of deciding what equipment they need and things like that. Our funding also was for only the first 3 years. Thereafter, we have been running without any external funding. And we have had to refurbish it once when the Infosys Foundation and the Canara Bank helped us. And then the government-supported project which we are having, that is supported by the Queen Elizabeth Trust through the PHFI. The World Diabetes Foundation gave us the capital cost for the equipment. Ashok Leyland gave us the van, okay? And then we put in the manpower and this thing, which was almost more than what is given by the this thing.
Okay, just to start with the equipment, this was in 2005. We were on the road in 2006 March, but it took us 6 months to set up, buy the equipment and all that. But the initial thing was about 2.2 crores. But there was one thing that we did. Even though the World Diabetes Foundation pushed us for cheaper equipment and stuff like that, we said we want top of the line equipment. So there is no compromise. If I want a Zeiss green laser, I will have a Zeiss green laser. I'm not going to make a compromise on that. I think that's all.
See, the first challenge, we came up with this idea that we should do it. This was actually an idea by my father, Dr. K.R. Murthy, that we should try to empower people, because every doctor wants to do the best for his patient. And many times just the economics defeats you. So he said, can we beat it in some way? And he said, you guys work on this line. So we drew up this entire project, and I think we went to some 5-6 donors and presented this. And everyone was sort of, it's something new, but no one was willing to risk a donation on that. Then we wrote to the World Diabetes Foundation. In the first round, it was not accepted. The reason why it was not accepted was that we were proposing to do fluorescein angiography on the van. So there is an element of risk involved over there. So the question was that suppose a patient has a reaction or something like that. So they sent it to one of the ophthalmologists, and they said it's impossible, no one has done that, don't even try it. So but one of the directors of WDF, she was her interest was picked by the idea, and she said, let's go and see them, whether they're capable of doing it. And we were fresh faces, just out of fellowship, and he was not even a medical person. And the Prabha Clinic is not such a big name, although it's a very old hospital. It's probably one of the oldest private hospitals in the country today. But many people didn't know about it. So they sent a person from World Diabetes Foundation, and we explained this whole thing to him. And for this particular question, in the initial phase, we were stopping near a general hospital and doing this whole thing, so that in case of an emergency, we have access. And we had understandings with the local physician that in case of an emergency, touch wood, till now we haven't had a need for taking recourse of that. But these were all built into it. But
some of the things that you don't see here is, like, for example, there's a full rescue kit. There's a crash cart on the van. There is oxygen cylinders, there is ambu bags, the staff are trained on rescue. So these things have to be done. The other this thing also was that many of the donors reached out to the equipment manufacturers as well, to Zeiss, to other people, to say, have you moved equipment like this? And they said no. So the risk was, what happens if your laser goes for a toss on the first journey? There's nothing, there's no insurance, the insurance companies were not ready to support it. The manufacturers were not ready to support it. But then those are the challenges that happened. But luckily after this, About, we know of 14 projects around the world that are running on the same model. And
do you get CMC from guys now? Do you get CMC from the OEM?
Yep, now we do.
Is it the same cost which I get?
Yes.
So how did you manage that?
No,
they have managed to sell another 6 lasers because of the training we have given. The 6 of our participants have gone in, and 4 of them have gone for Zeiss because they are so comfortable with it. You generally go for, you train with an Alcon machine, you will buy an Alcon machine. So they saw this thing in that potential to sell their products.
See, 83 ophthalmologists were not even entertaining them because they had no interest in buying these lasers or things like that. And now investing. There was a mission hospital. Where was this? Hassan. They had money. They had ophthalmologists. But nobody had actually gone to them and said, look, we have enough patient load. Please invest in a laser. The fathers and the bishop who was running the hospital, they had lots of money. But nobody had actually gone and said, we can. The normal thing would refer to Mysore or refer to Bangalore. Patient would go. But then what happened was that they did do the, after they saw that there was enough patient load within their own clinics, they invested. Now, where would they go for investment? They'll ask you what equipment to buy. You tell them, Zeiss is the best, it's worked. Yes.
Where I can go and tell you, I want this.
Yes, there is. So follow on to this. I am part of a national task force project now run by ICMR on a completely different medical need. This is hearing impairment. Same problems. They can't transport very expensive equipment. They need silence. Now it's running in 6 different geographies, right from Shillong to Bhuj. It's running, it's a national project. They are planning to make 60 vehicles like this. We were able to give the designs to Aisha. They were able to manufacture 6 of them in about 3 months. 26 lakhs.
That is including everything.
But here the vehicle was also soundproof. The vehicles now are studio quality soundproof. That means they can actually do complete audiometry. What you would do in a tertiary hospital can now be done on the field. So this vehicle can be built for about 17 to 18 lakhs.
Which company you think?
If we don't want to put the delicate retina stuff, then it probably
even be. Yes. But we would suggest that if you're putting in, one, go for top of the line equipment, because the life of it will justify. We have had to replace laser heads twice because the sheer number of lasers that you do. Even in a tertiary hospital, you're not going to do 30,000, 40,000 lasers, including YAGs or whatever. I've had to replace the YAG laser head twice, the green laser head once. But no alignment. That's the expansion of market for Zeiss, for Upper Sami, for anybody else. So that's the amount of new hospitals that have invested.
Each dot represents 10 ophthalmologists in that area. So you can imagine what effect it will make for a person who's selling it. It makes sense for you.
How do you charge the patients? Is it individual, whatever he requires?
No, we have certain criteria. We take the inputs of the local doctor much better. Okay, so the local guy knows what kind of, usually they even know families and they would have treated somebody.
So it would vary from patient to patient?
No. There is a standard rate and there is a free rate. That's it. There are no multiple rates.
Standard rate and free rate.
Yeah.
So what are your
standard
rates?
I think the most expensive one is about 1,300 rupees. Yeah, that would be OCT and angiograms.
So,
now you are doing FFA. FFA I've been doing from day one.
The initial hurdle
Yeah?
No need.
No need. See, normally what... It started with 70%.
To
the local doctor. Now it's 50-50.
About each procedure, whatever is.
Yes. Yeah, whatever. Is. So, but what happens? 50%. Yeah.
So,
because it's his time, no?
Okay.
His time, his patient.
His patient.
If I bring my man there and he doesn't bring his patient time, without work.
Yeah.
So.
If he has a patient and I don't bring my man, he doesn't have work. So it's a partnership. But there are certain unwritten rules, like for example, what do you do when, let's say, a vitrectomy comes up? Okay, what do you do when you detect a tear, for example, or when a glaucoma surgery? We don't insist.
They have not insisted on that also. Initially, the thought was that these guys are coming because they are starting their practice, they want surgical referrals. So, we made a statement that we will not solicit any surgical referrals.
But because of the goodwill and relations, how much percentage of surgical work you are treating from them?
I'll tell you what we actually lost on the surgical, because in the initial phase, we were doing so many free surgeries, and we ran through our entire budget, what we had budgeted for 3 years.
In the first year?
1 year.
Because a lot of free work was involved.
Yeah, no.
A lot of free work was involved.
Sorry to interrupt.
A lot of free referral surgeries.
So they're recording.
So then the World Diabetes Foundation realized that we were going deeper into difficult, because this was not funded by WDF. It was coming from our
pockets.
So
the surgical work.
Yeah, surgical work. So WDF was gracious enough to tell us that, okay, we are seeing that you are spending so much money. So they came up with an idea, okay, we'll fund your intraretinal unit. So
okay.
Initially we have a private hospital, Prabha, we have the charitable institute, which is Vitala. Vitala did not have the high grade intraretinal equipment. So they came and donated another 1.5 crores for
setting up a
setting
surgical
up
unit.
A surgical unit.
So these patients, when they came, didn't you think of including them into below poverty line scheme or some other government scheme?
But there were many schemes. I don't know.
Not working at that point of time for surgery. There was no support from the government.
Now I think they've got some 15,000-16,000 rupees they give.
It started in Karnataka, it started at 2,100 rupees.
Okay.
For a VR surgery.
Okay.
So subsequently, we also convinced the Infosys Foundation, and they were very nice too. Almost 3 years, they have supported any patient who cannot afford.
Okay.
So they gave us a base rate for 25,000 rupees. And any complicated intraretinal procedure.
So 25,000 rupees Infosys was ready to give you for any patient.
They have given not in this thing in the last 3 years.
Okay.
But initially, we did. There is an issue there. When we actually looked at epidemiology, for example, what's the number of patients that you're going to get in this particular area, we had no clue. Going by all the literature, it projected about 180 surgeries is what you will end up with if you screen so many people. We finished those, about 700 odd surgeries in the first year.
Okay, then you thought what?
Yeah, many of these patients were not even seen. Now, the thing is, once you see it, which is what I'm also fighting on the task force, is that once you know that somebody is hearing impaired, what next? You can't leave them, right? As a medical professional, you can't just, earlier he was just there, possibly going blind for unknown causes, but now that you have actually identified, are you going to treat him or not?
The local hospital patient referrals.
Yeah.
Certainly take care of that.
Yeah,
how?
They would refer it to a center.
Yeah, but what happens if...
an understanding. We do not give any cut on the referrals for any of our cases. So that is sometimes an impediment for getting surgical referrals. But then they do send a lot of cases. Many of them appreciate what we are doing and they still like to partner with us. So that's that.
See, what I have seen is a lot of doctors who are in practicing interiors, they've got liberty of getting land and everything at very cheaper rate. do they really need the equipment? Because I've seen my friends, whoever is in the two-tier, like, they've grown up tremendously well. They're like kings in their area. 3,000 square feet, 5,000 square feet land are by. We are in city because of the... See, if I have got to buy 1,000 square feet in Mumbai, I'll have to spend 4 to 5 crores. And if anywhere else would be like 4 or 5 crores, if you're spending, then you'll build a 3-4 story hospital.
Yeah.
No.
What is the person?
Okay, there are two assistants and a driver. That's all. That's it.
In the initial
phase, there would be two assistants, the driver, and one of us would. We would go in a car. And
training, like setting up the whole thing.
Yeah, that was all done when they started.
So who did that?
We did that.
Company people also.
So assembled it,
the company engineers.
Company,
they did.
Yes.
Mr. Kumar of Zeiss and Mr. Goenraj of Apas.
So everything, all the equipments are packed.
Completely dismantled every single day.
Every visit, you have to
every
single place.
Yes.
Every single place.
How much time does it take?
It takes about 18 minutes to set up the full, yeah. So we call it the Cinderella model. For that day, you become a tertiary hospital. So you go in, and for that day, you get everything.
Can you let us know something about the vehicle and the equipment packing and one shop?
I should know, but.
Or you go in a sequence if you have something.
Yeah.
Every time it comes back to Bangalore, or how
it
station there, because it would cross.
This one?
So I wanted to show you this slide. We wanted on the vehicle packing.
You can start your.
Yeah. Okay, there. Just stop there. Come on. So this vehicle, one of the things, myths that, which it's not a myth, but a lot of the challenges is power supply is erratic everywhere. So we carry our own 5 kVA generator. So generators have two things. One is that it gives you steady power, and it's cheaper in the long run. It's a petrol generator, it's not a diesel generator.
You can also draw from the practice. So
if need be. So this vehicle, vehicles are normally 12 volts or 48 volts. But this vehicle is an AEH 220 volt vehicle. There's a full, it's like a regular circuit that you would do in a hospital. It has got circuit breakers, it's got everything. It's built like a clinic. Just the fact that it's on a wheel. So two things we needed to do. One is, it's the conversation started with saying, how do you get this equipment for all these exhibitions? You're obviously bringing it from Germany or wherever it is, right? So wherever you hold AOS or wherever, the equipment is coming. You might fly it into Delhi, but after that, how does it come? So they said, no, we have special boxes to bring them in. And how do you bring them in? He said, we dismantle, put them in the boxes and bring them in. And neither Zeiss nor anybody else who sold us the equipment had any mode of selling the boxes. I told them, I want the boxes. We want the boxes from you. And they had no idea of selling the boxes. Part of the boxes are very expensive. In 2005, they were 800 euros each. Each box is 800 euros. What box you see? Can you please go back? It's called Pelican. The manufacturer is called Pelican, but Zeiss will sell you those boxes. They have form-fit molds. So this is how Zeiss itself ships from its factory to everybody. Yeah. Need to go back. So essentially, this is the boxes need to be procured. They have arresters, so the slit lamps move. A joystick doesn't move. You've got your rubber arresters. There are many. There are about 70 pieces of equipment that go into packing them. You can dismantle all of them. So the laser head goes separately. The base goes separately. It can all be put back. It can be trained. These guys were 10th and 12th standard pass. They were not even optometrists. So they can be trained. It's a mechanical skill. It can be trained. I learned, then I taught them. So everybody, the driver can assist. So they do multifunctional roles. The equipment needs to be, do you see this? These form fit molds that you see, like for example, this kind of polyurethane is used to wrap the lenses. And this is what Zeiss uses to transport from factory to you. They said if it can come through their transport, why will it not come through us? Yeah, we want it, yeah. You have to ask for the boxes. So these boxes are expensive. You don't see the external, this thing. External thing is aluminum. It's very thick aluminum. Can you just go ahead, one slide ahead? Yeah, that's the box. And it's packed. So this one, we tested in we had some friends from IIT Chennai. We put together this was tested with eggs actually. We put two plywood boxes and layers of eggs on your cartons. We took it around on a diesel auto to see whether the eggs would break. We went on experimenting till the eggs didn't break. This design is available, we'll give you the design. It's not a problem. It's called a rail mounted thing. This is what you would see in defense vehicles. They also carry very sensitive equipment like radars and sonars and stuff like that, but they also use the same thing. Just that the vibration forces are moved on a rail. It moves this way instead of up and down. This can be done. Then this is how equipment moves in an aircraft. This is just a cage with Velcro. So it doesn't hit anything hard. It just absorbs that.
This is also part of the...
Yeah, it's inside the vehicle.
Yeah.
No, we have built this, yeah. So you see this? These are the rails. If you see this, it moves on the rails at the bottom. The entire cage moves.
And there are shock absorbers on the side there.
That moves up and down.
Spring takes care of the vertical shocks.
Yeah. There are people who have experimented with air cushions instead of this. Not very successful. There was one that was tried somewhere near Noida. But then I think they went back to the springs. So even for the hearing equipment, I've gone for the springs. The entire testing chamber is put on a spring-mounted cage. Okay, so essentially what it now does is that it doesn't come back to Bangalore. We don't use a hub and spoke model. We use a circular model. That means once it leaves Bangalore, every day it does not travel more than 100 kilometers. The biggest journey is about 120 kilometers. So we leapfrog from place to place to place, go set up, get the local ophthalmologists are grouped together. It doesn't go. See, it's one of the things that happens is if you go to A hospital, then the other hospital will say, it's attached to them, we can't send. So usually we set it up at the IMA, or at the Rotary, or at the local
general hospital.
Or if the group of ophthalmologists is very cooperative with each other, it goes in cycles to various hospitals. But what we have done is, we have stuck to calendar days. We have said 22nd, if it is in Gulbarga, it will be in Gulbarga on 22nd, whether it's government holiday or whatever. So the reason why this is done is that keeping count of days, we all have mobile phones and calendars and stuff. It's very difficult in rural areas. If they know that second Sunday it will come, whichever, but stick to the common day. It always comes on that day. So 15th, if it has got to go to Shimoga, even if it is Independence Day, it will still go. Because the patient, he has to come for a 3-monthly checkup. That's all he is bothered about. He's not bothered about whether it's a holiday or whatever. But the local doctors pool. So there are two ways in which they schedule. Either they schedule by treatment. That means they pool all YAG lasers at one go. And every doctor's YAG lasers are done at one go. Or they pool by doctor. They'll say morning is this clinic, afternoon is this clinic, evening is this clinic.
Depending on volumes, we look at that. Because at a time, we can put in either the YAG laser or the green laser. So then the whole thing has to be pulled down and another one put up. So we try to encourage them to finish off the anti-segment lasers first and then go for the retinal laser.
In different
places, they have worked out now their own convenience bodies.
In some places, what they do is hospital will also give you space and examination chair and things like that. So you move the equipment into the
visual field machine, moves into the hospital.
Because many practices don't have space.
But you can always get new space at IMA or some place.
Yeah, but no, many things are iffy. No, IMA will not have power supply. No, many times it doesn't happen. IMA spaces, if you've seen, they're usually halls. You don't have multiple rooms, examination. operation rooms, we don't have treatment chambers. So if it's available,
so, there are some places which do not even have an IMA hall. So what,
or it could be a general hospital.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, yeah.
You can look at that. See, even there we are utilizing some of the facilities like that. See, for example, the field machine cannot run simultaneously with the lasers. So you will have typically about 40 patients totally. 40 patients totally who are coming in a place. Then there are about 15 lasers, and then there are about 4 or 5 YAG lasers. And then there are 2 or 3 fields. And you have a specified time of so many hours in which you have to finish your whole job. So running them simultaneously makes sense. So the field machine is generally moved into the building. So either the clinic of the doctor or into the this thing, and we do the field separately over there.
Okay. The other answer to why we don't go into a clinic is mostly social rather than anything else is, there is a bit of a resistance. Suppose 3 of you are practicing in the same locality and it consistently goes to one clinic. The patient's mind is, a clinic mein aata hai. It comes to this clinic. It doesn't come to the other 2 clinics. So
he is something special in that. So he ends up taking more credit than what is due.
We have had that as well, where we have pulled doctors aside. I know Praveen is very gentle on that, and I have pulled doctors aside and I have told them this is not fair. You can't claim exclusivity on. Some people have advertised and saying that I have exclusive tie up with Nayana. All that will happen. Yeah.
What about the legal issues?
What legal issue?
Permission. You have to collect permissions or.
For what?
You're going to do this type of film.
For what?
No, for laser. For now, with the YAG laser, I do it by clinic.
Yeah, we take a consent.
Yeah,
consent
yeah,
is
everything
taken.
Is done.
Consent is taken. Yeah. Yes, yes.
Yeah.
See,
as long as you're qualified to do it. If you're a gynecologist and trying to do PRP, then it's a violation. If you're an ophthalmologist, yes. Are you qualified to do it? You should have a. So we collect qualification papers, we collect registration papers. So there is a administrative thing that goes on as well. So we make sure that, let's say, for example, an optometrist will not come and do lasers. There are instances where optometrists run hospitals and ophthalmologists are.
Yeah. He is the person who is responsible.
It's not a camp.
It's not a camp. It's not an open camp which you're announcing to the public.
We are conducting the
treatment. Yeah. Treatment on the.
At the IMA hall. Okay, sir. We start anywhere clinic, we have to take permission from that and look at the
authority. Correct.
And you are going once in a month.
Correct.
For that place, you are taking permission to conduct it.
The local doctors take it.
The local doctors.
Local doctors take it, saying that I have an adjunct clinic. Yeah, suppose, let's say you are an operating surgeon. Look at the reverse. Okay, let's say you're an orthopedic surgeon or you're a gynec surgeon. You go to 5 nursing homes. What permission do you take? The nursing home needs to be certified. And you need to have your own individual certification. Okay, if I go and conduct a screening camp in a village and collect 300 patients, then I need to do something.
So I need to inform the local authorities, get the permission from the DHO and all that. For this kind of a treatment, it's the local doctor who is responsible for his patients.
His patients.
So a lot of the responsibility is shared by the ophthalmologists who are partnering with us. Yes.
Yeah.
Correct. Correct.
Yes. There are somebody who is running it commercially in Tamil Nadu. He has moved it to, the last I heard, he's moved it to Gujarat. He had a van. He would. A lot of people have been doing this, like hiring the YAG laser has been a constant thing. It moves around. But nobody has done it in a concentrated manner, like a full retina clinic or a full glaucoma clinic. Because some of the equipment is not treatment. They're just diagnostic. Like you won't get a UBM B scan, for example, on hire.
But for that, you need that certificate that you are not going to use it for prenatal sex
determination. So the machine is registered, and in that registration, we put all the participating doctors.
What are the licenses and registration things you need for your bank itself, not for the doctors and the patients?
Okay. First of all, when we started it in 2005, there was no license for mobile hospitals. There was only ambulance license that was available. But today, there is an amendment, thanks to a lot of ophthalmic hospitals, including SN, Arvind, Raj, everybody put into this thing, successful projects are put up. So now there is a class of vehicles called mobile treatment units. You can actually go to, you can it's called Form 22A from the RTO. You can file it. Your bodybuilder has to certify that it's as a mobile treatment clinic. Form 22A. From the bodybuilder. He'll give it to the RTO. RTO will register it as a mobile clinic.
This is one thing. Another is, like, do you need the license from the health ministry?
No.
You
no.
Any permission from the CMO in each of the district?
No.
Wherever you are operating?
No.
You're sure about
yes. The local doctor, the only thing that you have to ensure at every single time.
He is
qualified. And you need a copy of his certification with you. You need copies on that on the van as well. No, no. It's only transporting, no?
That's it.
Yes. You need a PCP and DT registration depending upon what your local state health authority says.
Right.
The B scan needs to be registered.
Yeah.
But what I would suggest is that just attach. They'll say who are going to use this equipment. One part of the PCP and DT certificate is the number of people who will use this equipment. You just need to attach the entire list of doctors that you are going to use.
Keep a check.
What? Yeah, they are empowered to shut it down. Yeah. Yeah, so Aisher can build it for you. Aisher Motors can build it for you. Yeah, there are many bodybuilders who will actually build it for you. Ours is, there's in Bangalore, there is Azad, there is KMS, there is Bangalore Bodybuilders. In Chennai, there is... See, the thing is that you should see, one of the things that we were trying to see was, that's the map that we showed you. When we did a survey, there were only 5 centers where even lasers were available.
That is the
reason. Yeah. So, that's...
You are having ophthalmologists who are practicing. Many of them are not having access to this equipment.
Yeah, that is the reason.
So,
because you want to think about the idea, you give the thought that at the same time, the government
takes action. See, I would suggest a deep pre-survey.
We'll
a deep pre-survey.
Right?
Let's say, for example, you didn't. One of them is even here. Dr. Venu is here. Sir, you want to say something? He's a participant on Nayana. He works at.
I'm going to
So I'll take your question immediately after answering that. Sir, to answer your whether it is feasible in Tamil Nadu, okay? We give the design. We have made it what is called as an open patent, so the design is available. Up to what millimeter size springs you need, it's available. Those things are available. You have to write formally to Vitala. We'll share the email address. Then if it's a commercial venture, we'll charge you. If it's got a social cost to it, we'll give it for free. Yes. Yeah. We will tell you what chassis to buy, where to build, how to build, what you should buy, which brand of generator you need to buy, up to the level of how to ask size for the boxes, we'll tell you.
I would request the participants to use the mic because they're recording the whole thing.
Okay. Unfortunately, we are a very small organization, even today. So we don't have, we can tell you and we can vouch for certain people who will do the entire package deal for you. That's what we did for the government of India. It was all the 6 vehicles that are currently running and have been built in Bangalore and shipped everywhere else. So we know the manufacturer. We told the manufacturer this is a package deal. Government is more difficult to deal with. They will not give 10 different invoices and stuff like that. It was tendered, taken as one value, flat value, and it transferred the vehicles.
You said that some person was building with
Aisher.
Aisher
is
the Aisher is.
No, he did, they do everything. There has to be a qualified ophthalmologist practicing there. That's the only criteria. That's it. Even if it's one, at least one. Yeah.
You have built it on Ashok Leyland.
Yeah. That's because we didn't have a choice. We went to Ashok Leyland. They gave us this chassis.
Okay.
The chassis.
Today this chassis cannot be used. I think it's no longer.
It's no longer allowed. It's BS2 or BS3. This is so. So the later ones, yes, you can.
Basically,
this vehicle is Ashok Leyland. Yeah, the one that you saw is Ashok Leyland. But now it can be built on any vehicle. Any 9-ton vehicle. You need a 9-ton class vehicle. That's what it is called.
So you go to Aisher Motors directly, you tell them that you want a mobile health clinic for ophthalmology.
You tell them that I need this 12-ton AC vehicle with this design. They'll build that for you.
12-ton AC vehicle with this design.
Yeah.
So that design, what you will give us, tell them and they can do it.
Yeah. The reason why we say 9-ton vehicle is that you need that treatment chamber to be at least
long enough
and wide enough. The width is controlled by the government. It cannot be wider than 8 feet. Height is also controlled. It cannot be greater than 3 meters. 3.5 meters is the max that you could. That's the chamber height, cannot be more than 10 feet.
So it runs well on the road without any worries or something?
Yeah. It's done 15 lakh kilometers.
Right.
So it's hearing things together individually, I'll tell you, they're running in Shillong, Shimla, Bhuj, Bangalore, Raipur, and Bhuneshwar. So very varied terrain, varied kinds of this thing. Collectively, they've done about 11 lakh kilometers. 6 vehicles together, last 3 years.
The one in Shimla is owned by government?
Yeah, Government Medical College. You can go see it in the Government Medical College.
Do I have staff at alternate?
No.
Do they have a building to be on the road all the time?
Finally, we would like to acknowledge them.
So he doesn't come back to Bangalore at all?
No.
He comes once in a month.
Once in a month. Yeah, you can. See,
so
there
what
are.
What happens is sometimes you send across a driver who
changes.
So you sort of shift them around.
So normally what we do is we train about 3 sets of people. So you can take over, people can take leaves, people can split the duties. The more responsibility you give them, the
can talk to them about the software which we have now designed.
So now.
Will it be economically viable if we don't take any help of any NGOs?
I'm telling you, there are guys who run this commercially.
Pricing has to be right, that's all.
There are guys who are making profits on this, who are not NGOs.
Is there any possibility of not dismantling the equipment and transporting it to a small distance also? If
no.
It will damage. All,
you ask guys, they will not allow you to move the laser from one room to another in your own hospital.
Suppose if someone is planning for such kind of a unit to roam about in a city only and not go outside.
No, you can talk to Dr. Natarajan. He built it at AGH, Bombay. Natarajan has a vehicle. Same design. They came to us. They studied the thing. We gave them the design. But he put it on a bus. He goes only to Dharavi from Dadar. But even then, we suggest dismantle.
We have a Vitra green laser, and we put three slit lamps at different places, and we're moving the single green laser in our own vehicle in the box.
See, as long as there is a standard box for the Vitra green laser. It needs to move.
We are doing it since last 2-3 years, and even the OCT, we have optopole OCT.
Yeah.
So that we have been carrying to different centers. So we've been doing it for last 3 years, and it's working pretty
it
well.
It will work.
The only concern is the insurance issue. You know, you need to get the thing insured, the equipment insured.
So what I would
see,
we'll
just tell them about the ROP project which we are doing. So we also have a retinopathy of prematurity prevention project where we have a ret cam which costs almost 60 lakhs or something.
No,
it's 1.3. So that goes around in a car. So we had a Tata car.
Vista,
which used to go around, now that completed 3 lakh kilometers, so we have another one.
We place it on another Vista.
So this has been going on for last seven years or so. And same, the equipment moves to different NICUs.
You get your equipment insured?
Yes.
Yeah.
So what
it has to be.
I'll tell you.
Yeah.
What you have to do is, there is a specific insurance by the General Insurance Corporation of India or Foreign Insurance.
Yeah.
It's called the Comprehensive Electronics and Malfunction One, this is purely from a physics point of view, is I would suggest do not take it on an Innova or a Sumo. Invest in a car if you want to, but do not take it on an Innova or a Sumo. Basically, because both these vehicles, Innova, Tavera, Sumo, are all built on a chassis called a ladder chassis. Okay, so the entire chassis is weighted down by the engine at one side, and it acts like a tuning fork. Even though the vibrations are not felt by humans, the equipment will vibrate. If you want to transport it in a car. Even a Maruti van is fine, but not a, or the Versa is fine, or the Eco, what they will call it, that is fine.
Jump
but
so much.
No, not the van, but this thing. You
no,
can
no.
go on a car.
You can go in a car, but not a.
But Maruti van also, what you're suggesting?
No, I'm saying it's even, it's better than the Innova.
Better than Innova.
Yeah. Because it doesn't vibrate at the chassis level.
Okay.
It vibrates at the entire vehicle level. But the chassis level vibrations are the worst.
Okay.
If you saw this vehicle also, it had iron beams to isolate. Trucks are the same problem. They're built on a ladder chassis, and ladder chassis are not good. Yeah. SUVs, no. No SUVs.
You need to change the suspensions and the
shockers. The suspension will act on the vehicle, but the equipment will still bounce up and down. See, the ROP, so what we have done is that once the other critical part, which you don't see here, is you need, earlier we used to maintain paper records. The biggest problem is that a cataract surgery is like a fire and forget. You do once, unless he has a problem, you don't see the patient at all, unless he comes back for your glasses or whatever. But whereas this patient needs to keep on coming back to you for repeated examinations.
A typical ROP would require one visit, no ROP. Week later, you need to again look at the retina, third week, and then you say that this baby is not going to develop.
See, same issues as with diabetic retinopathy. Every 3 months you see him.
You have a circle, right?
Yeah. There also you have a circle.
There also you have a circle. You link up to the NICU. So the car with the equipment goes there with the technician. He takes the photographs. He uploads it. And then the specialist in Bangalore looks at the pictures. Now suppose a laser is required, he goes and treats. The laser is sent, or we link up with the nearest retina fellow or retina specialist who will go and do the laser. Or we go and do it. alternatively, if there is a review which is required, the baby is called back. The numbers are stored. So a reminder call is sent to the parent saying that such and such a day the van is coming, please come for the checkup. And if he misses the checkup, a phone call is given to remind them to come back. So this whole thing has been worked out in the software.
So currently, No. So the Karnataka government was one of the first governments to actually start it as a state government project. So they pay you per screening or as a tender fee for the year. They'll take care of all your costs. You will never make any money. They'll take care of all your, they'll say per kilometer, whatever is the government rate. They pay some 4 rupees 50 paisa per kilometer. Whatever is the standard, they'll pay you. You need to maintain records. You need to submit. Most of the, see, there is a government policy that says that every district headquarter hospital has to be minimum 200 beds and should have an NICU of at least 20 ventilators or 20 warmers, what they call it as. Now the issue is babies have started surviving more and more. Earlier the statistic would never enter anything because many babies did not survive. Now they survive. Now because they are surviving, they need secondary care, right? They need eye care, they need cardiac care, they need other care. So the issue is how do you do this? The Karnataka government is one of the first governments to, there is now a national task force as well on ROP screening. One of the model is this, to do remote screening, central diagnosis, local treatment.
Screening is free, but if you have to laser and all that,
it's still free.
That's also free.
Yes, that's part of the mandate that the government gives.
No, the laser is done free for patients in the government NICUs, but in the private NICUs, we charge for the laser. And if it is done by the local retina specialist, he takes his this thing. We provide the laser for him on that particular day. If we do it, we charge that amount.
So now the last phase of the project, what's happened is?
Initially for the 8 districts or so, we covered for the first 3 years when this project was launched. Subsequently, now Narayan Netralaya is running for the entire state, and they're doing a great job of that also. So it's been going on very well. The model is the same model which both of us are following.
So we still continue to service a lot of NICUs that are not covered by
the government. So we go to many private this thing. Now, right now, we have expanded to about 13 districts.
So that
where we
the cost of red can be just to
yes.
Exactly. So, see, basically there are two aspects to it. One is, of course, the running cost. We still run on donations, but it's easier to raise donations for ROP because there is an appeal of a child going blind. The second thing is that when you project the savings that you do by preventing him from going blind, so even when you advocate it to a government or something, there's a tremendous increase. So taking care of a blind child through his lifetime or him taking care of himself versus him being able to see what he can contribute. That difference is again stark. Okay? I'm not saying that a blind person doesn't contribute. I'm saying that what that difference that you make becomes very significant and it's easier to advocate it to.
Dual use thing. We didn't even get it as a. See, there was a question that was asked as to what are you going to do for immobile retina patients or who are bedridden diabetics with amputations or whatever. How are you going to screen them? Because the whole model is towards the patient will be mobile, will be able to sit on a chair and you'll be able to do. So then we said there's only one equipment, which is a red cam. So we can actually take it to the bedside and screen. That's something that we can do. Now, if you can do that, and since the equipment very rarely you use the red cam. We said, what other use you can put it to?
So we did a further project called CODE, Comprehensive Ophthalmic and Diabetic Care. So this one involved trying to enthuse physicians to try and use, you know, esthesiometers to look at sensation in the feet, look at blood flow in the blood vessels of the leg and stuff like that. I'll finish in 5 minutes. So this is how we, this thing, and we approached the World Diabetes Foundation for the same grant. We got the grant, and part of the grant was the red camp. And they were happy that it was being put to a dual use. We had told them that we'll use for both purposes, and they were aware of it, and they were happy about it. We achieved our numbers, whatever numbers we had given to them for the 3 years. Code doesn't run now. We were unable to convince our physicians to spend the time the way we were able to convince our ophthalmologists about what Nayana did to them. So there, I think we were not a complete success in that project.
So what we did was we took a comprehensive lab on mobile clinic, not just, because currently it's based on availability of equipment and the patient affordability of what tests they run for a regular diabetic, forget ophthalmology. So microalbuminuria, for example, is never run unless there is an acute renal issue. So the big issue is how do you get a consistent standard of, so we put a full lab in something called a lab in a box.
You've done something like zero by empathy. This is required by the company, buy that
It didn't work out very well. We couldn't compete with the local labs. I think we are overshooting our time.
Anything
and
important, what like
the most important thing would be to thank these three people who travel 26 days each month. And people who are doing the back-end jobs. And the three drivers who drive the,